Hello everyone, I am Nishat Fiza. I am doing my PhD in Department of Physical Sciences, IISER Mohali. I welcome you all on behalf of India March for Science Chandigarh chapter. First of all, thank you for joining us. I would request everyone except the speaker to switch off their video and mute themselves and switch it back on when you ask questions. So today we are going to discuss about NEP 2020. National Education Policy 2020 has been introduced after a gap of 34 years since the previous education policy. The draft was published in May 2019 and it has been subjected to many discussions among the students and teachers in academia. The 484 pages of the draft has been converted into a 66-page document and has been approved by the Union Cabinet of India as NEP on 29th of July 2020. The education policy is a comprehensive framework from elementary education to higher education, and in many aspects, it is a broad guideline and advisory in nature. It is up to the states, institutions, and schools to decide on the implementation. Professor Soumitra Banerjee will talk about the implications and impact of this policy. I would request Shuchatana to introduce the speaker for us. Over to you.
Hi, I'm Suchetna Mitra. I'm a second year BSMS student in IISER Mohali. Today we are privileged to have Prof. Soumitra Banerjee among us. He's an Indian electrical engineer and a professor at the Department of Physical Sciences, IISER Kolkata. Prof. Banerjee's research mainly focuses on nonlinear dynamics and bifurcation theory. He did his graduate studies at Bengal Engineering College of the University of Calcutta, from where he earned a BE degree in electrical engineering in 1981 and moved on to the Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi, to gain an M.Tech in Energy Studies in 1983. Then he enrolled for PhD at IIT Delhi, received his doctoral degree in 1988. He took up the post of a lecturer at the Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur in 1985 and served IIT Kharagpur till 2009. In 2009, he moved to the Indian Institute of Science Education and Research, Kolkata, where he still serves as a professor. Prof. Banerjee has been adorned with numerous prestigious awards and fellowships, which range from being elected as a fellow of the Indian Academy of Sciences, 2005, and the Indian National Science Academy, 2007, and then the World Academy of Sciences, 2012. The Department of Science and Technology awarded him with the J.C. Bose Fellowship in 2015. He has also been the recipient of the prestigious Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award. Aside from having such an illustrious career, Prof. Banerjee also keenly participates in enriching scientific temperament in the society. He is a general secretary of the Breakthrough Science Society, which aims towards achieving this, and has also led the March for Science since its conception in 2017. Prof. Banerjee, it's indeed a pleasure to have you among us, and we look forward to gaining insight and knowledge regarding this policy, which will affect students' careers and futures. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. It is really a pleasure for me to speak to the students of IISER Mohali, students and maybe also some faculty members. And indeed, the national policy on education is a very important thing which every student must be concerned with, because that is how the education is going to be shaped in the future years. And for anybody in the field of education, it is obviously a matter of very great importance that how the education is going to be shaped in the future years. I'll start, let me share the screen. Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So while we discuss the new education policy, first we need to understand what is the problem that are ailing the academic community. What are the problems that are facing the education system in India? And in order to do that, let's see. Here, this part is, can we get rid of this? Okay. So first, let us just take stock of what are the problems. Because any policy essentially has to identify the problems and have to address them so that the problems go away and we see a newer future. The first problem is that in the education has not reached a vast section of the Indian population. Even the education policy document, actually this was from the draft education policy document that was released in 2019, it said India currently has the largest non-literate population in the world, with the absolute number of non-literates among the population aged 7 and above being 282.6 million in 2011. India also hosts the largest number of youth and adult illiterates in the world. So this is the ground reality that we are trying to tackle. And in the last 40 years, the same draft education policy says, in the last 40 years, a number of programs have been started, such as the Rural Functional Literacy Program, National Literacy Mission, the Sakshar Bharat Abhiyan, etc. Despite all these efforts, India still has over 280 million adult illiterates, which is about one third of the total number of adult illiterates in the world. Now, this is a bleak situation indeed. Even after 7 decades of independence, which essentially implies that so far all the governments have not taken education seriously. The schools are in bad condition. Most schools, school buildings are unfit for any practical use. Many do not have roof over their heads. And then many do not have toilets, especially the girls' schools do not have proper toilets. And the number of teachers, the teacher to student ratio is abysmally low. And as a result, the new education policy admits that the gross enrollment ratio, GER, for grades 6 to 8 was 90.9, while the grades 9 to 10 and 11 to 12, it was only 79.3% and 56.5%. So enrollment ratio is so low, indicating that a significant proportion of enrolled students drop out after grade 5 and especially after grade 8. Note this point. This new education policy says that most students drop out after grade 8. As per the 75th round household survey in 2017-18, the number of out-of-school children in the age group of 6 to 17 is 3.22 crores. This is extremely large. And if you look for the reasons, you will find that the standard of education at the government-run schools is very bad and it has been going down over the years. There are a few causes that we can identify. First is deliberate degradation of the examination system and the no detention policy, almost automatic promotion every year up to the class 8. And that is why when the students do not have any examination, they do not have any, they don't give any importance to preparing the things that are learned. And as a result, the learning outcomes are really very poor. And the first time they face examination is in class 8, and that's when they actually drop out. So the no detention policy has been used to show that so many people have been into class 8, but the reality is that they do not really acquire proper education even to be fit for a class 3 or 4. And the abolition of English in the primary and the lower secondary levels, all these put together have brought down the standard of education at the government-run schools, and the English medium private high-charging schools have mushroomed. Even the lower middle-class people nowadays want to give their children to the English medium schools. And that's a retrograde thing that has happened. And the government's own admission is that in this NEP document, in Article 2.1, they say, however, various governmental as well as non-governmental surveys indicate that we are currently in a learning crisis. A large proportion of students currently in elementary school, estimated to be over 5 crore in number, have not attained foundational literacy and numeracy. That is, the ability to read and comprehend basic text and the ability to carry out basic addition and subtraction with Indian numerals. So this is a really pathetic situation in our country. And the students, as a result, are now divided into haves and have-nots, two classes. Those who go into the government-run schools and receive a low-quality education, and those who are educated in private schools and receive a relatively better quality education, that have examination, that have English education, and things like that. And naturally, when it comes to going into higher education, when it comes to the getting jobs, the haves have an advantage, and the have-nots are perpetually kept out of the whole education and job market scenario. And the curriculum, whatever is learned, is heavy with unnecessary content. Those who have gone through class 11, 12, many of you have, you recall that many of the things that are now studying in college were actually done in school, which was pretty much unnecessary. And at that stage, you were given only a very superficial idea, only the vocabulary, the jargons regarding the things. You didn't really develop a concept. So this was really unnecessary. So school curriculum has to be properly framed. My child, for example, had to memorize how many menu items there are there in the edit menu of MS Word. Why should you remember that? Why should you memorize that? Tomorrow a new version will come that will have a different number. Yet these are the things that are included in the curriculum, and that's why things are unnecessarily heavy. And that there has been degradation of language teaching. Language is a vehicle of thought, vehicle by which we express our ideas. And since nowadays the situation is that one can get high marks without ever learning to express the thoughts in written or spoken language, therefore, we get students who cannot write papers because they cannot express their thoughts in proper language. Since the language is also a vehicle of thought, if you cannot acquire a proper grounding in language, higher thoughts cannot go to you. You cannot absorb higher thoughts even. So that is another problem. And through literature, we get a good idea about ethics, morality, and things like that. We get an idea about the culture around us. And that is also something that is missing in today's generation. And the result of today's education is that even after going through education, many people actually get a very unscientific way of thinking. Various unscientific beliefs and superstitions still remain ingrained in their thought process. And that's because most schools do not have any experimentation. They learn things from just the books, by reading the books. And why is something true? Because it is written in the books. 500 years back, people said that why is something true? Because it is written in the Bible or Quran or whatever. It is exactly the same thing that is happening today. And as a result, schools are not acquiring a scientific bent of mind. That's another major problem. There is poor enrollment higher education. In the own admission of the government, the gross enrollment ratio in higher education is only 26.3%, the record of 2018. The number of colleges, universities, hopelessly insufficient to cater to the required number of students who want to be enrolled for higher education. And the standard of universities has eroded due to various governmental intervention and the lack of funds. All that put together has resulted in the situation where the university education has been eroded, while in its place, a few favored institutions have been created, IITs, NITs, ICERTs. So, and a large share of funding go to us. I am also from an ICERT, so I know. Though I would not say that the funding is adequate, even at IITs, NITs, and ICERTs, but the funding situation in the university is really pathetic. As a result, they cannot really carry on good amount of research. So in this background, we are talking about the NEP. So whatever 9 problems I have, I could think of, that these are the things that could be, that have to be addressed. Let us see whether or in what way the new education policy addresses them. First, let us come to the vision of the new education policy. This national education policy envisions an education system rooted in Indian ethos that contributes directly to transforming India, that is Bharat, sustainably into an equitable and vibrant knowledge society by providing high quality education to all and thereby making India a global knowledge superpower. It says, the vision of the policy is to instill among the learners a deep-rooted pride in being Indian, not only in thought, but also in spirit, intellect, and deeds. So these are very lofty ideals, I would say. But you would say this, you would notice that this is very strongly rooted in nationalism. Whether the nationalism is the right thing to instill in a student or not, that is another question in which we may have differences, but this is how the NEP envisions the future of India. Whenever I discuss anything, I always try to look at the positives in that. So when I was reading the new policy of education, I was essentially trying to look for what I can really appreciate. And there were a few things. There were, in fact, many things. I'll first present them because I'm really glad that this new education policy mentioned these. It says, indeed, with the quickly changing employment landscape and global ecosystem, it is becoming increasingly critical that children not only learn, but more importantly, learn how to learn. This is a very important point. Education thus must move towards less content and more towards learning about how to think critically and solve problems, how to be creative and multidisciplinary, and how to innovate, adapt, and absorb new material in novel and changing fields. Important points. I'll be really glad if these are really implemented. It says that education must build character, enable learners to be ethical, rational, compassionate, and caring, while at the same time prepare them for gainful, fulfilling employment. It says, it is based on the principle that education must develop not only cognitive capabilities, both the foundational capabilities of literacy and numeracy, and higher order cognitive capabilities such as critical thinking and problem solving, but also social, ethical, and emotional capabilities and dispositions. Important points. I'm really glad, I would be really glad if these are, if I see in future, these really come to fruition. It says, quality higher education must aim to develop good, thoughtful, well-rounded, creative individuals. It must enable an individual to study one or more specialized areas of interest at a deep level and also develop character, ethical and constitutional values, intellectual curiosity, scientific temper. They mention about scientific temper, very important. Creativity, spirit of service, and 21st century capabilities across a range of disciplines. As I said, these are the good things about NEP that I really liked. Now let us see what their policy is and how they plan to bring these to fruition. And that is where I was really disenchanted, because I saw that these wishes, that this is how the next generation of learners should be. I saw very little embodiment of that vision in the actual practices that are going to come into effect. The principles of this policy, they clearly state the purpose of the education system is to develop good human beings capable of rational thought and action, possessing compassion and empathy, courage and resilience, scientific temper, and creative imagination with sound ethical moorings and values. Good. So I first stated what I really liked about the policy, the statements of the partners, how they really want to shape the education. But let's see. Let's proceed. How they want to shape the school system. Presently, we have a 10+2 structure of education, they wish to modify it into 5+3+3+4 system. Presently, it starts from age 6. They want to start from age 3. So it is covering 3 to 8, 18. First, the foundational stage, 3 years of primary, 2 years to pre-primary, and 2 years of primary stage. Then preparatory stage, class 3 to 5. Middle stage, class 6 to 8. And the secondary stage, class 9 to 12. Interestingly, they say the foundational stage will be managed by the Anganwadi system. Now, the Anganwadi system that we have in our country is meant for a completely different purpose. And the Anganwadi workers are already underpaid, overworked, and small in number. And that is completely insufficient to handle a huge number of children aged 3 to 6. And they also need a great deal of training in order to really, the way the NEP envisions the education for the grade 3, three-year-old kids. In order to really do that, they have to be properly trained. Now, the NEP envisions that the education should begin with fun-making, light textbooks in grade 3. Subject teaching begins only in grade 6, not before that. So, essentially through plays, through fun, through games, and through various activities, children should learn. That's good. But in order for that to be really fruitful and really learning experience, those who manage that activity should be very well trained teachers, not the Anganwadi workers. But unfortunately, that is how it has been envisioned. Now, this has already been tried out once in the DPEP system, the District Primary Education Program system that was tried out in Kerala and some other states. It was a World Bank promoted program, and it also envisioned the initial part of the education to be basically play-based. That's good. But what actually we experienced was that actually no education happens because they only play, and through the play, channelizing their ideas into something that requires extremely well-trained teachers, unless that is there, it really makes no sense. And it may be possible if the teacher-student ratio is something like 1 to 20, while in today's schools, it is like 1 to 80 or 1 to 100. And in that situation, if they only play and there is no actual learning, up to grade 6. Now that is dangerous. And the new education policy envisions that the semester system will be introduced in grade 9. Semester system is 6 months time, basically 4 months. As you know, you are used to it. That is okay for the higher education. For the school level, they need to study something for a longer length of time. Otherwise, they forget what was learned in the last semester. And that happens. We do experience that even in the college level. So that is why I would say the semester system is not apt for the school level. And the vocational education starts at class 6. And what I earlier said, that the no detention policy has caused enormous harm to the education system, that is remaining intact. And there will be exams only in class 3, 5, and 8. So effectively, not every year there will be an evaluation. They will just study or not study. And only at this particular level, there will be some examination. That will not serve the purpose. And how do they plan to expand the reach of education? Now, the plan is, the education policy says that a few schools within a radius of 10 kilometers will pull their resources together and become school complexes. So that if one school has a playground, other school can use it. One school has some facilities, other schools can use it. One school has a laboratory, other school can use it. Just imagine, you have to go 10 kilometers to another school to do some experiments. Will it really work out ever? It will not. Unfortunately, that is how the whole planning is, because the government does not want to spend enough money to build up the resources in every school. And the open and distance learning will be the method of increasing the reach of the education system. Now, you know, now that we are in the pandemic situation, we have to take recourse to the online teaching. And we know that many students are unable to absorb that just because they do not have connectivity. Now that we are experiencing in the ISERs, which are, you know, upmarket educational institutions, just imagine the marginalized farmers, children of the farmers, and the people who are in the countryside. Do they have connectivity? Do they have laptops? And still the government is planning to expand education using the open and distinct learning system. So, and unfortunately, there's no serious plan for strengthening the public school sector, but instead, there are repeated mentions that there will be a greater role for the private schools. It says that at the same time, the private stroke philanthropic school sector must also be encouraged and enabled to play a significant and beneficial role. Effectively, this will lead to commercialization of education. And what kind of knowledge will be imparted? The knowledge of India, it says, whatever I'm writing in these parts, these are actually the article number in the policy document. Huh? So just refer to that. Knowledge of India will include knowledge from ancient India and its contributions to modern India and its successes and challenges. Indian knowledge system, including tribal knowledge, indigenous and traditional way of learning, will be covered, included in mathematics, astronomy, philosophy, yoga, architecture, and all that. An engaging course on Indian knowledge systems will also be available to students. Now, the point is that in that garb, various unscientific beliefs and superstitions can also find its way into the education system. And this is very dangerous. And notice that in the whole Indian heritage, they repeatedly talk about Indian heritage. Not a single time there is mention of the heritage of the Indian freedom struggle. So by the Indian heritage, they repeatedly mean the legacy of the Vedic education system. And the content of education, they say in Article 4.29, all curriculum and pedagogy from the foundational stage onwards will be redesigned to be strongly rooted in Indian and local context and ethos in form of culture, traditions, heritage, customs, language, philosophy, geography, ancient and contemporary knowledge, and so on and so forth. So essentially, they will mix those ideas that in ancient times there were aircraft, there were all sorts of advancement of knowledge, all these ideas that have been doing its rounds in WhatsApp, those things will now become mainstream material to be taught. I'm very concerned about this content of education. Another problem is that the whole focus of the NEP 2016, is that it essentially is geared towards promoting vocational education, skill development. Even though its preamble, what I said I liked, those things are not related to that. They say that they will develop thinking process, they should learn how to learn and things like that. All these are there, but effectively, the whole education process, right from class six, it goes into vocational education and skill development. That means there will be carpentry training in the school, there will be, you know, cooking training in the school, there will be stitching of clothes in the school. So these things will be part of their education. Now, and they say that by 2025, at least 50% of learners through the school and higher education system will have exposure to vocational education, for which a clear action plan with targets and timelines will be developed. So that means the vocational education runs through the whole of the education system. Now, this focus on skill rather than focus on developing a thought process, thinking individuals, that is importantly the focus of the whole education system. That goes 180 degree different from what initially they said, which I said I liked. So we feel that the development of personality, thinking capacity, quality of mind should be the primary focus. They should be able to argue rationally, think rationally, and that should be the primary objective. Albert Einstein says the school should always have as its aim that the young person lives it as a harmonious personality, not as a specialist. Otherwise, he, with his specialized knowledge, more closely resembles a well-trained dog than a harmoniously developed person. So that is one thing I find rather disturbing about the education system, that its whole focus is on vocational education. Now let's come to the language policy. They propose a three language formula. English will be only taught after class 5, and there'll be two other languages, and one will be, of course, the mother tongue, but there'll be one more language, and two other Indian languages, and there'll be emphasis on Sanskrit and Hindi. In the draft document that was released in 2019, it was only Sanskrit and Hindi, and then there was a lot of objection from the southern states, and so now they have included various other things, including Pali, Persian, Prakrit, Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Malayalam, Odia. And this will also be offered. Just imagine. In a school in say, Thiruvananthapuram or some other place in Kerala, would you expect Odia to be taught? Or would you expect Prakrit to be taught, for that matter, Pali to be taught? These are only to find mention in the education policy. Ultimately, what will happen is that only Sanskrit and Hindi will be available as available languages, and you have to choose. So effectively, it will result in imposition of these languages. We feel that the right policy for a multilingual country is a two-language formula, the mother tongue and English. And English is very important because it is the medium of science. It's a medium of knowledge internationally. It's not a language only of a particular country like America or England. No, it's not like that. It is now the vehicle of thought, international, and it is our advantage that we have English. And English has to be taught right from the primary level, so that when a student leaves school, he's well versed in English. He can read, he can write, he can converse. And the whole amount of higher knowledge is available to him or her through the medium of English. I'm not diminishing the importance of mother tongue. That also has to be developed, and all that knowledge has to be made available. But do you think today scientific literature is available in all the mother tongues? No, it's available in English. So the problem is with Sanskrit. There is enormous emphasis on Sanskrit. It is a rather long passage from the policy, but I will request you to read it, because this essentially talks about how they plan to shape the education. They say, due to its vast and significant contributions and literature across genres and subjects, its cultural significance and its scientific nature, rather than being restricted to single stream Sanskrit pathshalas and universities, Sanskrit will be mainstreamed with strong offerings in school as well as in higher education. It will be taught not in isolation, but in interesting and innovative ways, and connected to other contemporary and relevant subjects such as mathematics, astronomy, philosophy, linguistics, dramatics, yoga. So when mathematics will be taught, it will be taught in conjunction with mathematics in Sanskrit. Astronomy will be taught in conjunction with astronomy in Sanskrit. And we have trouble with that, because these, definitely there was some development of astronomy, mathematics in Indian soil. We are very proud of that. But that is something that happened 1,000 years back. Today, that mathematics is not the mathematics of the 21st century. That astronomy is not the astronomy of the 21st century. It says, thus, in consonance with the rest of this policy, Sanskrit universities too will move towards becoming large multidisciplinary institutions of higher learning. Then they say, Sanskrit will become a natural part of holistic multidisciplinary higher education. And there will be a 4-year integrated multidisciplinary BA dual degree in education and Sanskrit. Thus, they will actually integrate Sanskrit education to the whole of the education system. And this is something I find problematic. I personally like to learn Sanskrit. Why? Because I'm interested in the development of mathematics and science in ancient India. And I would like to read Bhaskaracharya or Brahmagupta in their originals. But that is due to my own specific interest. Not everybody has to learn that. And instead, what they're trying to do is to push Sanskrit to everybody's throat. And that is that's something I think is problematic. So the caution that I would like to give you is that this may be used to propagate an indoctrination agenda, where the Vedic age is painted in the picture of an imaginary glory, Pushpak Vimanas flying everywhere, surgeons planting elephant heads on human torsos, missiles flying with nuclear warheads, Brahmastra, and doctors giving birth to test tube babies, and all that things that you have been hearing in WhatsApp University. Those things are might come as a mainstream matter of learning. I see, even though they say that rationality and scientific temper will be cultivated, the actual text of the policy reeks of anti-science attitude. This they say, the rich heritage of ancient and eternal Indian knowledge. Now, there's no knowledge that is eternal. All knowledge is transient. Today, whatever I have knowledge, that may at some point in time become obsolete. So that has to be, and they say that eternal Indian knowledge and thought has been a guiding light of this policy. And from the early child care to education, they say that everything will be controlled by what they call ashram shalas. And that is very troublesome thing, because the ashram shalas may be essentially things that are controlled by religious fanatics. What kind of changes do they foresee in higher education? That they say, see that all higher education institutions will be compartmentalized into three possible compartments. A, research intensive universities, teaching universities, and autonomous degree granting colleges. Presently, there are many colleges that are affiliated to universities. This system will be abolished. All colleges will become autonomous colleges, degree granting colleges. So every college that is in any nook and corner of the country will become autonomous, able to grant their own degrees. And obviously, these degrees will have no value whatsoever. Colleges will compete with each other to give as much marks as possible without any learning. And it is something that we'll see in a few years. It will completely ruin the education system. Presently, if a student is studying in a college but ultimately passes an examination conducted by the Calcutta University, he gets the stamp of the Calcutta University, and that matters. Presently, they are planning to abolish that system. Every institution will become this. And then there will be universities also of two types. One, research intensive universities, and only teaching universities. Imagine, many of you are doing PhD. After that, if you will definitely look for a job. If you get a job in a teaching university, you will get no option of doing research. Universities, by their concept, is research come teaching. Generation as well as dissemination of knowledge. That is what universities are and should be. And that is something that is being planned to be changed now. The undergraduate program, BSc, will become either a 3-year program or a 4-year program. And the student will have option of exiting at various levels. If they exit in the middle, they will get a certificate. And if they leave at the end of the 3 years, they will get a degree. And so on and so forth. At the end of 4th year, they will get a more stronger degree, something like that. And in that system, presently, you get a degree in physics or chemistry or biology and botany or whatever. They are trying to bring forth a system in which you can mix and match any course. If you are studying physics, you can also take a course on catering technology. And that way you can earn credits, and there will be an academic bank of credits where you can accumulate credits earned from different places, even online courses. And finally, that will be accumulated to give you a degree. That degree will be hodgepodge of various things. We know that in order to study a subject, there are certain ancillary subjects that has to be learned. In order to learn physics, you have to learn mathematics. You can't help it. But now the system is such that one can learn a completely different thing And there'll be a complete disarray in the knowledge of the students. And there is enormous emphasis on online system. That means presently, this time online courses have been conducted because of the pandemic situation, but now we are seeing a new normal where the online open distance learning, they say ODL, online system will become the major part of the education system. And that's very dangerous because then there will be no communication between the teacher and the student. And the student cannot see the teacher. This is not an education system that I recommend. So there, according to them, the online education is here to stay. They clearly state that institution will have an option to run open distance learning, ODL, and online programs, provided they are accredited to do so. And this will be used to increase the gross enrollment ratio. That means most students will actually not come to colleges and universities. They will be at different places scattered, and they will attend classes through mobile phones. Now, this cannot be a major way of increasing the gross enrollment ratio. That's what they're planning now. The governance of education now has become, they're now planning a completely different structure of governance of education. There will be one higher education, HECI, and that will have four pillars. It will stand on four pillars. One is the National Higher Education Regulatory Council that will regulate higher education. There is one National Accreditation Council, NAC, that is already there, but they will integrate into the structure. Higher Education Grants Council that will actually give grants to the colleges and universities, and Higher Education Council, which is the which will effectively set the curriculum framework and things like that. And the whole thing will work in communication with National Skills Qualification Framework, NSQF, which will essentially look into the skill development and integration of vocational education into the higher education. So notice that education was actually in a concurrent list, center as well as the states, but now they're making it a centralized system of governance. And in that centralized system of governance, it is essentially, it will be more or less governed by bureaucrats rather than educationists. And that's a very dangerous trend. And the whole thing now, I see that it is paving a path to commercialization. For example, their education policy says all higher education institutions, private, public, and private, shall be treated on par within this regulatory regime. Regulatory regime shall encourage private philanthropic efforts in education. Essentially means more private colleges, more private universities, more private engineering colleges, and things like that, effectively charging a hefty sum of tuition fees. Private higher education institutions having a philanthropic and public-spirited intent, this is only a veil, will be encouraged through a progressive regime of fees determination. This will empower private higher education institutions to set fees of their programs independently. So they will set their fees. You can easily understand the fees will go up. The whole thing is actually a plan for all-out commercialization of education. And the policy also calls for rejuvenation, active promotion, and support for private philanthropic activity in the education sector. Effectively, this will be encouraged and the number will increase. In financing research, they clearly say in Article 17.3, they clearly say that despite this critical importance of research, before that they describe the importance of research, the research innovation investment in India is at the current time only 0.69% of GDP, as compared to 2.8% in the United States of America and 4.3% in Israel and 4.2% in South Korea. This is a dismal situation. And solution? They have created a new funding agency called NRF, National Research Foundation, somewhat like the NSF of USA. What about the present funding agencies, DST, DBT, CSIR, and things like that? They will presently exist, continue to exist, but the focus will shift to the NRF. It's very clear the focus will shift to the NIRS, and these funding agencies can disburse funds depending on how much fund the government gives them. And if the focus shifts to the NRF, they will slowly, funds will be siphoned from them to this funding agency. Presently, whenever I want to submit a project proposal, I have various options to submit it to. If it does not work out in one place, I can submit to another place. If it is a single funding agency, the whole education, whole scientific research will be controlled from one place. And this very centralized system of research is not a very good system of funding research. And the financing education, in this policy, Article 26.1 says, unfortunately, public expenditure on education has not come close to the recommended level of 6% of GDP. Now, this 6% of GDP was recommended in the 1968 education policy. It was reiterated in the policy of 1986, which was further reaffirmed in the 1992 policy. And all these policies said that they will increase it to 6%. It is not anywhere close to that. And this policy also says that they will increase it to 6%. Now, if in 70 odd years after independence, the governments after governments did not think it fit to increase it to 6%, but everybody promised, it's only another promise. And there's another catch. The catch is that if you state it as a percentage of GDP, that also includes governmental as well as private investment on education, and private investment is in order to get money out of that. So effectively, it is not really a financing education. But the question is the government really serious about this? Now, those of you who are in the education sector have noticed that for the last few years, financial support for education has been continuously reduced. And the science fund funding for the science funding agencies like DST, CSIR, and those things have been continuously reduced. A couple of years back, CSIR declared financial emergency in the system. DST is unable to support those projects that they have actually approved. Money is not coming, right? And the ISRs, IITs, NITs, that are sort of privileged institution, even in institutions, the government is continuously pushing us to increase the tuition fee. The IITs, in one shot, the tuition fee went from 90,000 to 2 lakhs in one semester, in one go. And the ISRs and NITs are also being pushed to enhance the tuition fees, and we are not at liberty to set our tuition fees. Government says that. And does this reflect a serious intent of the government to increase the governmental outlay on education? It does not. So, and now they are planning the infusion of foreign direct investment into education sector. They are saying that 100 foreign universities will be allowed to open shop in India. And obviously, what is really needed is to increase the quality of education system in India, rather than getting some second-rate universities from abroad, but that's what they actually ultimately are planning. And it is to be noticed, the process that was followed in formulating the policy, a committee was formed under the headship of a retired bureaucrat, Mr. T.S.R. Subramaniam, who submitted a proposed policy in 2016. Very few came to know about this. Only those who actually visit the page of MHRD, they saw that there is a 230-page document out there. So practically nobody came to know. The stakeholders did not come to know. And a draft policy was released in 2019. And now, in 2020, the final policy has been adopted right in the middle of the pandemic when people cannot really do anything about it. So this is, I would say, as a take-home message, I would say that when I was reading the policy, I was sort of elated initially when I saw that very something that is very close to my heart, that a science policy, a education policy, should talk about fostering scientific temper. A education policy should talk about making the learners learn how to learn. A science policy, education policy talking about education being a enabling students to think. I was really elated. But when I really went through the steps that they plan to take in order to make that into action, I find that there was no intention of doing that, really. Because if really somebody intends to inculcate a scientific temper in the students, most importantly, textbooks should tell the student, don't believe anything without questioning. Students don't believe anything without evidence. It should present experimentation as a seeking evidence activity. Don't believe it unless you see it happening in front of your eyes. I do not see any real intention of the government to really do that. Every student should experiment. Through that, they will learn. I don't see anything like that. I don't see any mention that you have to understand how the scientists think, their thought process, how science teaches you to think. That is not there in the whole of the education policy. Only the words scientific temper are there, have been put in. So in my opinion, this policy might spell a disaster for the future of education. I will end here. If there are questions, I'll take that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. That was a very enlightening talk. So now, if anyone from the participants want to ask questions, they can raise their hand and unmute themselves, introduce themselves, and then ask questions.
Questions okay. Can also be in the chat box.
Yes, sir.
Then you can read it.
Nishab, can I?
Yes, sir. Shubhadeep. Can you please switch on your video?
Yeah.
Yes.
Am I audible now?
Yes, you are audible.
Thank you for this talk. So as I am right now in Europe and I see that lot of things, kind of arguments are provided that this for exit in and out kind of once one wishes to join a course and then leave are propagated that it is being practiced in Europe and USA to defend the new education policy in India. So my question is what is possible in socioeconomic structure of Europe? Is it possible in India? This is number one question. And number two, what I see in Europe that along with education, in school education, lot of importance is being given to sports also. So not only a human being should learn, but they should be also physically and strong individual. Is there any guidance in the new education policy regarding sports? Sports day or a sports event in school, but regarding infrastructure development like playground and other things, is there any?
Yeah.
So these are two questions.
Yeah. I will start with the second question. There is talk about sports, promoting sports and things like that. Not only sports days and all, in general, making students physically active and those things are there in this policy. But the means of doing that is that, as I say, the schools within a radius of 10 kilometers will be pulled together to make school complexes. And one school may have a playground, another school 10 kilometers far away will use that playground. And some school may have a gym. School students of another school may use that gym, and that kind of system they are proposing. I have serious doubt whether this will work out. Okay. The first question regarding the students coming in and opting out of courses. Here, this is proposed in the context of the BSc or BA course, bachelor's level course. And they propose that it will be either a 3-year course or a 4-year course. There'll be initially some first year, second levels is things are mixed up. But after one gets into a subject, after 1 year, one can opt out. That person will get a certificate, not a degree. What good that certificate will be is doubtful because nobody will get a job based on that. And only after completing the 3 years, they will get a BS degree. And after completing 4 years, they will get a B.Ed. Along with the BSc degree so that they will qualify to become teachers. And one can come in, go out at any stage. I'm not making any particular comment about coming in or going out because that is something that we'll see how it really pans out. We don't know. All I'm saying is that discomfiture regarding the policy is essentially the mix and match of completely different things to make your pool of things that you'll study. Every discipline has some ancillary subjects, as I said. Unless you know those things, you cannot really get a comprehensive knowledge in that particular discipline. So if you allow a student to take any course, then obviously he or she will take the courses in which more marks come, or so there are various other considerations that actually play. So that is a problematic thing that I found in this course. Okay. Any other question?
Thank you.
So any other question? Aradita? Yes. Can you switch on your video and introduce yourself first?
Hi, I'm Aradita. I am in Dublin now. I basically have a few things to mention. One question basically is, is there any mention of how the evaluation will be in the higher education institutions? And also in the draft policy, it was mentioned that non-performing schools and colleges will be, dismantled or taken up by the private philanthropic ones. So are they still there?
The second point that you mentioned is still there. That means there will be a accreditation mechanism. And those schools and colleges that do not fulfill that criteria will close down.
Okay,
that's one. The other issue was regarding the examination. Examination now will be conducted at the BSc level by individual colleges, not by the universities. Okay, so in each individual college will be able to award their own degrees. So examination will be conducted by them, and they're complete freedom to choose their mechanism of examination.
And also the syllabus.
Syllabus, yes.
They'll be choosing.
Yes. Okay. So individual small colleges will choose their own syllabus. Yes, there will be a recommending body. As you said, that there are four levels under the HECI. One of them is the fourth one is something that sort of recommends a certain syllabus for every course, but that's not binding on the colleges.
Okay.
So ultimately, what part of the syllabus will be covered and all that, everything will depend on the colleges. Effectively, what will happen, I can tell you, is that individual small colleges, nobody knows their name. Their degree will have no weightage. All they will try to do is to give everybody full marks, and then you go and find your place. It will be no education at all. That's the problem. That's what I foresee as the problem that's going to come. Any other questions?
Also, another thing I wanted to mention, one aspect is like this, this Sanskrit educational, the importance of Sanskrit that's been mentioned. So there are Sanskrit schools and colleges. Well, I haven't really seen colleges, but schools I have actually seen. And most of them are like they would propagate and promote gender biases, caste biases, and like they will not enroll students other than say from Brahmin.
Right.
So it's like that. So I mean, I have serious doubts on that
part. Me too. I completely agree with your point that Sanskrit schools are there. Sanskrit colleges are not there, but this policy says that not only colleges, Sanskrit universities will be there. Okay. And science departments will operate in the Sanskrit universities where science will be done in Sanskrit. Okay. So this is the vision of the policy. And yes, there are, for example, I studied in Ramakrishna Mission, which is a religious organization that's a school run by the Ramakrishna Mission, and we had to study Sanskrit. But it is something that is whose aim is to propagate a certain religious idea. Yeah, so that will, but this is one type, but this kind of, what should I say, schools that are essentially meant to propagate religious ideas, gender bias, caste bias, will now multiply.
Yes.
Sir, I have a comment. So what yes. Aradhita mentioned is that those grading of institutes and then taking down institutes which are not performing well. So we are, the government is not setting up new institutes. So there are some existing institutes and initially they will be evaluated and on the basis of their evaluation, they will be funded or not funded.
Yeah.
And eventually they will be evaluated again and taken down. So already the institutes which are not doing well will get lesser funds and perform lower and then they will be taken down eventually. So in this current scenario, we already have the student to institute ratio is very high. And
yeah.
Further
need,
taking
need
down...
Need to increase the number of institutes, yes.
Right. Further taking down institutes, how is that going to develop the numbers
to a developed? It will not. But they do say that they will open new institutions. The policy does say that. It's not that they are completely silent about it. They say that how many and how, we don't know. That's not very clearly mentioned. But the policy does say that we'll open new institutions also. But the problem is that right now we need to at least double the number of colleges and universities in order to accommodate the number of students who are coming out of school in order to accommodate them in a proper way. So you need an enormous funding as well as manpower input into the education system. Manpower input means they have to be paid salary. So funding has to be increased significantly, at least doubled. What they say is essentially that the promise that was made in 1968, they're still saying the same thing, but there is no signature as yet that they are really meaning to do that. As the earlier governments did not really mean to do that, it was only in policy. Probably this will also remain in policy.
So thank you for the answer. So next, Ritom wanted to ask a question. Ritom, can you unmute yourself?
Yes, sir. So you mentioned something about open
on. Introduce yourself. Introduce
yourself first. Yes, sir. I'm Ritam Das. I am a student at Isar Mohali, currently in my second year.
Okay.
So you mentioned something about having open online courses or online courses in general.
Yeah, yeah.
So how are they going to be different from the current Coursera or NPTEL course that we have right now? So if that is an optional thing, so shouldn't that be beneficial for people who cannot attend the university in person?
Good. Good question. Actually, NPTEL, MOOCs and things like that, Swayam, these things are good as supplementary material. If you are unable to attend a class, you can always get that material somewhere else and things like that. But what is coming in this education policy is that these courses will be seen as a means of an alternative form of education. Okay. So they are now envisaging a kind of education in which the bulwark will be done by these online courses rather than teacher-student interaction in the classroom. Teacher-student interaction in the classroom will be there, but a major part will be taken off by the online courses. And yes, if somebody is unable, due to his own problem, unable to join a university, for example, he has got a job and still wants to learn, obviously these supplementary things will exist, should exist. I'm not questioning that. I'm questioning that they are saying that the online courses will become a way of increasing the gross enrollment ratio, GER. Now that is a problematic thing, but because then they don't have any reason to increase the number of colleges and universities. Just sitting at home and attending online classes. And at the end of the day, you get a degree. So this is what is going to come. And that is what I have objections with.
Okay, thank you. We'll get it.
So next we have a question from Shomo De. Shomo De, you can unmute yourself and introduce yourself first.
Yeah. Hello, sir. I'm a postdoc in IMSC in mathematics. Mm-hmm. So does the policy say anything about the employment aspects, like jobs after education? So one of the aims of education is, of course, getting a job. And a related question is there any mention about career counseling while, say, a student is in class 11, 12, and he or she needs to choose the path? So is there any mention about career counseling for students?
Career counseling, yes, there is mention. There's mention. How the career counseling will be done, that's not mentioned, but that there will be, they want to introduce the system of career counseling, that is there in the policy. That's true. But that does not mean the number of jobs available will increase in any way.
Right.
The number of jobs is actually going down every year. And you may have seen one TV news that came in WhatsApp a few days back, that in Moradabad, there was an announcement that they will take, you know, Safai workers, and 58,000 people applied for that. And many of them are, you know, graduates and postgraduates. So they were, cleaning nalas. So this is happening because there is no job in the market. Now, what they are actually trying to do now is, essentially, there will be a two types of education. Presently, it is there. The government schools and the private schools. Presently, that kind of two types of education is there. In the government school, they will learn carpentry, they will learn stitching, they will learn cooking and things like that. And in the private school, they will learn computer programming and things like that. So that is, again, another way of creating two kinds of citizens. So that is a problem. So vocational education, remember, does not get you a job. Most people who actually do a job like repairing bicycle, they learned it outside the education system, right?
Right.
The person who actually does your carpentry in your locality, he did not learn it in school. Now, if you bring that to school, you're essentially diluting what otherwise could have been taught as way of teaching the student how to think. So that is a problem. So we do not object to at all about there being a vocational education. Vocational education is there. But the all-out vocationalization of education is something I have doubt, I have trouble with. Okay, engineering colleges are vocational education, right? There can be medical colleges are vocational education. Won't they be there? Of course they'll be there. Knowledge. Yeah, they'll be there. The ITIs, the polytechnics, will be there. I mean, no objection about it. It is the vocationalization of the rest of the education. That is what we have.
So what does it say about this career counseling? I mean,
I did not pick it up from there.
There are not many people who can do career counseling in a right way, right?
Yeah. Well, it just mentions in one line, but I read it somewhere. That's why I say that it says that. Huh? But it just mentions it just one line in one particular clause that the students will be counseled about their career choices. But how, at what level, by what means, I don't know.
Okay, thank you.
So next we have a question from Shourav Dash. Shourav, can you unmute yourself and introduce and then ask the question?
So hello, I thank Professor Banerjee for this wonderful talk. I am a student in ISO Mohali, a fifth year student. So my question is that one of the problems of our current education system is that there is a lot of burden of the board exams. Some of the other problems which are concerned with this is that people have to leave many of their own personal interest for this single exam. And if you just fail that exam or don't able to get your desired marks, then there is just no option. Your career gets a huge turn back. Some of the other problems is that there are many of the private organizations which do businesses based on these board exams. So as far as I have studied the National Education Policy 2020, they have addressed this problem, and they have proposed some new examination systems. I don't know how much this new proposed examination systems can solve this problem. So I would like you to give some light on this matter.
Yeah, you are right. This education policy does talk about this particular problem and does attempt to address it. They say that the pressure of, presently we have got a 10th class exam and 12th class exam. That will go. There will be one exam. But then they have built in a provision that one can appear in the exam twice.
Right.
Yeah, twice means the second time to improve the score. If one time due to some reason it was not good, this student was sick or something like that, there is another opportunity of improving the score. That is a good thing. I would welcome that.
Another point that I would like you to enlighten is that with the present infrastructure, the new education policy that it aims or it promises the changes that it can bring into our education system. Do you think that the present infrastructure of education system can be used or can help those promises to fulfill? Even a slight change of the syllabus for the examinations or the curriculum, the present infrastructures of our education systems cannot actually fulfill. I have actually experienced. So I'd like you to enlighten that matter.
Yeah, it is true. Our educational infrastructure is abysmally poor. If you go to any rural school or not so privileged school, you'll find that's practically breaking down. So and normal colleges, if you go, you'll find that laboratories are abysmally bad. So experiments cannot be done even in colleges. So that has to be definitely improved. But that requires a lot of financial involvement. And I do not see any hope on that count, because even though they say that it will be raised to 6%, I mean, as I say that if that happens, I'll really be happy. If that happens, I'll really be happy. But the signatures are otherwise. So yes, the present infrastructures are hopelessly insufficient to bring to fruition the dreams that one sees about the education system.
And is there any of the articles or any of the parts of the National Education Policy 2020 had been invested in showing how to develop these infrastructures, to develop this environment so that we can actually bring in the promises that the National Education Policy have promised?
No, actually, the amount of lines spent on infrastructure development is very low.
Right. That I also failed, actually.
Yeah, it is very low. But they do mention that they will build more schools and colleges. That is there. That mention is there. That's all.
Thank you.
So next we have a question from Shyamabrata. Shyamabrata, you can unmute yourself and please introduce yourself first.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Shyamu. I'm a PhD student at IFFO in Barcelona. Thank you, Professor Banerjee, for the talk, and I hope you are well. I have one comment and like a couple of short questions. So in terms of the comment, like throughout this talk and the parts of the NEP that I've read, I always got this feeling that there is a clear attempt at entrenchment of the stratification that already exists while also adding new levels to the stratification. So in addition to the private school, public school dichotomy that we know already exists, there's talk of this vocational education, but importantly, vocational education for only 50% of the students, if I remember the quote correctly from the slide. Then there's also this business of 3 years and 4 years. And when you're studying in private institutions, there's a financial question that comes in when you make that decision. And so on and so forth. And this is basically at all levels throughout, not just school education, but also higher education, the teaching universities, research universities, autonomous colleges, and the value of the various degrees that will be earned by students from those places. That's it with regard to the comment. And the questions I have, the first question, and I think I already know the answer, but I still would like to know this for certain. So the school complexes in a 10-kilometer radius business, are private schools supposed to be a part of that? Or is this only public schools?
They don't mention that. They simply say schools within a radius of 10 kilometers will be marked as a school complex, and they will share their resources.
Okay.
Public and private, they don't mention.
Okay. I ask because obviously the disparity in resources between private and public schools is
quite stark. But it's also true that if a private school has some resource, it's hardly likely that they will share it with.
Of course, and we have seen this with the RTE and the 25% reservation.
This is going to happen. Yeah.
And my second question is, so you mentioned, especially at the beginning and then later again, the thing about lack of examinations and no detention. And you tie this into learning outcomes and dropout rates after standard 8. So my question is specifically, if there were exams before, so you're saying that exams appear in standard 8 and therefore students drop out after standard 8. If there were exams before, wouldn't students also drop out earlier? Like, wouldn't you have the same dropout rate just spread out over multiple years instead of it happening at the end of year 8? And also the claim you make about learning outcomes in terms of literacy and numeracy, the only sort of empirical study I know about is the ASER reports, the AACR reports that come out every year. And I mean, even before Kapil Sibal removed examinations in lower classes, the statistics from the ASER reports were terrible even then. So I don't see that there has been a change with the removal of exams, but just that the education system has been horrible for a very long time.
No, the point is that students drop out due to various reasons. The most important reason is their financial condition, due to which they are forced to work either in the agricultural fields or some place. They have to be earners. And that's one of the main reasons for their dropout. And that reason is not going away now. But there is another reason. They're unable to, their inability to cope with the demands of the education. Now, if at every stage in class 1, whatever is to be learned, they learn and then they go to class 2. Class 2, whatever are to be learned, they learn and they go to class 3. In each year, there is only incremental demand on their intellect. Okay. But if there is a long period due to which they are never examined, whether they have actually learned things or not, and they're basically automatically going up to class 8 without the learning outcome, the government's own document says that abysmally poor. In that situation, they first encounter the examination, they fail, and then they basically drop out. This is an additional reason to drop out. This is not the economy-driven reason to drop out. Okay. So economy-driven dropout is there, has been there, will be there. But this is an additional reason to drop out. And even those who go to higher levels, they're also, because they remain deficient in some aspect, earlier, say some students did not learn how to multiply. and they go to class 8. And then they realize that that's something that I should have learned. Now, it's not easy for them to learn at that level because there are things to be learned at the class 8 level itself. So point is that this sort of drives students to desperation, and many students drop out because of that. The education, the experience in schools, in at least the state I am from, West Bengal, is that before this idea was introduced that there will be automatic promotion up to class 8, this second reason for dropout was not there. The first reason was there. But now the overall quality of the government-run schools have abysmally gone low because of this. Because there are many students at the class 8 level whose level of learning is not even at the class 4 level. They're there. You have to teach them. Therefore, your teaching has to be at the class 4 level. The overall quality goes down. And that has been the experience of most teachers in government-run schools.
Shyamaprata, does that answer your question?
Yeah, for the most part. But
is there anything that I missed?
No, so basically the thing about literacy and numeracy and whether this has changed as a result of no exams, and you mentioned evidence from Bengal.
Point is that, yeah, the evidence means I'm not talking about any statistics being taken, but I am in touch with various teachers in schools, and they all say that after this was introduced in the last regime, actually, after this was introduced, the quality of education that they can impart in the students has gone down because there's so much disparity in this among the students of a particular class. So much disparity. So they cannot really teach. So that's the issue that I'm talking from personal experience of interacting with the school teachers.
When I was in college, and this was before the UPA had brought in these measures, UPA 2, I think, and I was helping a student with his schoolwork, and he couldn't divide, and he was in standard 9. So I've this anecdotal evidence that you mentioned, I've also experienced to some extent. But what I was saying is that there is this thing called the Annual Survey on Education Report. It's a literacy and numeracy test survey done across all states in India by an NGO. And they publish this report every year. And they have been doing it, I think, now for over 10 years. And those statistics have always been terrible. If you look at it, like a student of standard 5 unable to read a passage in their mother tongue or unable to subtract, and because they do basic tests in just language and math, not other subjects. So if you look at those reports, there has been no qualitative worsening before and after this decision was brought in by the UPA 2 government. So anecdotally, yes, of course, but statistically it would seem that it's just as bad now as it was before. It's not improved in any way, but it has also not become significantly worse.
I cannot answer that question because I have not seen the data. Therefore, I cannot directly answer the question. Only thing I can say is that this particular report, NEP 2020, mentions that there is a sharp drop after class 8. But the only way I can explain that is the first time they encounter examinations in class.
That makes sense, of course.
Let's go to the next question then.
Okay. So next, we have a question from Shuchatana. Shuchatana, unmute yourself and please introduce yourself first.
Okay. So I am a second year student from ISER Mohali. And my question is basically the first time NEP was heard of, the main thing that came across was that it's going to be divided into the 3+5+5+4 system. And after 10th, that rigid boundaries that you have to choose at either arts or science or commerce, that won't exist anymore. And now you can study in an interdisciplinary way, which in thought sounds very good because people are indecisive in 10th standard as in what they want to do in life. And also in reality, I want to know that what is exactly the practical measures of carrying out interdisciplinary studies, like how do you theory you're supposed to be able to study history, physics and music together or something. How is that supposed to translate into higher education, and how is it, what is going to be the outcome out of it?
Yeah, you can presently the proposal is such that you can study physics, cooking, and say something like that. You can do that. See, the point is that interdisciplinary thinking and education is good, but this is anarchy. There is a difference between interdisciplinary studies and anarchy. Interdisciplinary means somebody who is in physics should know something in biology, so that if there is something to be culled from the ideas in biology into his own research, his or her own research, then he or she will be able to do that. Interdisciplinarity means you have some some exposure in another subject, related subject. Okay, you can definitely study music. Music is your passion, you can always study that. But study means learn music from somebody. But physics and music and cooking, if that becomes a combination, then you actually are not being anything. You are neither being a physicist, nor being a cooking specialist, not being a musician. That is the problem. You're becoming jack of all trades, master of none. The point is that, if, for example, the system of education that we have in the ISERS, initially a few years you learn many things, but not everything under the sun. That many things are also somewhat chosen by some consideration. And then at some stage you specialize, then also you have some option of taking some courses from outside, but not absolute anarchy. That means you cannot have everything free. You have to, if you are choosing physics, you are choosing chemistry, you are choosing biology, then you have to choose certain subjects. You have to have root in that particular subject. And then there are ancillary subjects. So that is all right. But presently the way it is being proposed is in the name of interdisciplinary thinking, it's becoming a complete anarchy. Students at that stage, at that level, at that experience are not able to wisely choose what is good and what is bad for them for the future. Suppose somebody wants to be an economist. What are the subjects he or she should choose? In order to be a good economist, a student of that age is not able to choose that properly. And so there has to be certain subjects you have to choose in order to become an economist. And there will be some other subjects optional that you can choose from other things. Okay. So a proper education system is there has to be proper mix and match between core subjects, departmental elective subjects, and open elective subjects. All right. Not everything should be open. If you do that, then effectively you produce people who are ultimately good for nothing. That's not good.
Okay, sir. So, sir, now I have a question.
Sure.
So the unemployment statistics currently reaching new heights in the country, and then this new education policy has so much emphasis on vocational training. I mean, isn't this going to worsen the situation? I mean, creating more unemployability rather than unemployment. What do you think of that?
Yes. Unemployment is something that is a disease of the economic system. It cannot be addressed by education. If there is employment available, then the employer will automatically get people and train people in order to play that role. Okay. There was a time when normal science graduates, commerce graduates used to get jobs, and then after they got job, they got trained in that particular area. That's how things used to work. Now, the question is whether you should impart that training, specialized for a particular vocation in the school and college itself, or will you leave it for in-job training where a student gets a proper grounding in thinking and then gets into a job and gets trained in the job. That could be, I'm not demeaning any job like the carpenter's job or a safai wala's job. I'm not demeaning that. Every job requires specialized skills. But whether school and college are the right places to impart that skill or not, I have doubt. School and college are the places where you have to learn how to think. You have to learn how to learn rational thinking. You have to learn the history of this humankind. You have to learn how the social society functions. You have to learn how what you have learned about how the nature works in science. These are the things you learn in school and college, and the specialized those skills you can learn always with the time at your disposal after the education is over. You can always do that. If you mix those, if you make imparting the skills as the purpose of the education, then you are essentially weakening the actual purpose of education. That is the problem. Okay, so education cannot really address the unemployment problem. If employment is there, the employers will always find people to serve their purpose. They will train people. So it's our economy's chronic crisis that is creating this problem. It's not something that is created by education. The lack of vocational education is not the reason for unemployment.
We don't have any more questions, as I can see.
Nisha,
Manu,
maybe a last question I wanted to ask.
Oh, sure.
Rami. So Shomitoda, I wanted to hear a little bit more on, because at some moment you mentioned the Sanskritization, at least the government is giving that so much of emphasis on Sanskritization of education. But we know that this Sanskritization of education initially was tried or even proposed by this British, during the British rule. And the Renaissance personalities like Ram Mohan, Vidyasagar openly came out and actually stood against, strongly criticized. Even Rambon said that this is the best way to keep the Indians into darkness. So do you really think Sanskritization of education will really bring education? Or is it really possible even? Like if I want to teach mathematics in Sanskrit, can it be a good vehicle even to bring the mathematical logic inside?
Thank you for bringing this issue. Actually, historically, this is what you said is fact, that when the British wanted to create an education system in this country for their own purpose, to create a band of people they will serve them, they first wanted to continue the kind of education that was existing already, Sanskrit based, Pathshala kind of system based. They did not want to bring in the European kind of education, which is based on the ideas of Enlightenment and Renaissance. It was Ram Mohan and Vidyasagar who sort of forced them to bring in that against their own will. One important point that Vidyasagar made, because in his time, Sanskrit was the medium in which all knowledge was imparted in the college, mathematics included. So in mathematics, they had to teach mathematics using Brahmagupta's book. Brahmagupta's book was written, not Brahmagupta, Bhaskaracharya's book. It was written in 1100s. That means 700 years before Vidyasagar was there. And obviously in the meantime, mathematics has enormously advanced. Teaching of mathematics has advanced. For that time, for 1100, Bhaskaracharya's work was novel, new, wonderful, but not in the context of the 19th century. So for the 19th century, this was actually old, should not be continued in a teaching. It can be a subject of our sort of curiosity, how much they advanced at that time. Yes, you can do that. Historiography of science is an important thing that has to be done. Yes, for that it is important, but not for everyday purpose of teaching mathematics. So if now, again, the teaching of various subjects, physics, chemistry, mathematics, astronomy, all these are brought in through the medium of Sanskrit, essentially you'll be teaching things that are 700, 800 years old, because in the meantime, some 800 years was Indian dark age. There was no cultivation of science at that time. So you are bringing in the material from that time. That is something that is only of interest to historians, not of the common students. That should not be taught to the common students. What the common student should be taught is the is a, is a the mathematics and science and history and geography and economics of the 21st century. And that is not available in Sanskrit. So Sanskritization of education, what they actually mean, I'm not just claiming things. That's why I took trouble of actually copying and pasting from their own document into my slides so that you know what actually they said. It is an all-out plan of Sanskritization of education. And through that, they plan to inculcate a sort of their own agenda, which they have been telling in various fora for a long time. Now they are bringing it as a part of education system itself. Okay, so okay. I'll stop here.
Yeah, thank you.
So now we are very much well past the meeting time.
Yeah, so let us stop now.
That was a really great discussion, and I want to thank the speaker once again, and also some fellow students here from ISER Mohali, Shuchetana, Moyuk, Kala, and Onnishika, Shubhadeepda as well for your constant support, and many others who I am not able to name right now. Thanks to all of you, and thank you so much, sir, once again. And now we can end the meeting.
Thank you very much.